Well, mental health is something that affects more people than you might think. In fact, an estimated 43.4 million people in America have some kind of mental illness.
47 ABC's Julian Sidor has been working on a special series about those living with mental illness and the struggles that they face, and he joins us live in the studio, as you can see, for part one of his four-part series. Hi there, Julian.
Hey, Emily and Lenita. Well, life can be tough for all of us, growing up, trying to find our place in the world, trying to be productive members of society. Well, for those struggling with mental illness, those struggles are compounded. During this four-part series, Breaking the Stigma, we get to hear from four people living with mental illness who have made it through recovery and are now leading productive lives within society.
I just wanted to disappear. I wanted to die.
That's just one description of living with severe mental illness. The story for many who don't get help. It's for that reason that four extremely brave individuals have agreed to share their stories. Meet Charles, Vivian, Dave, and Brittany, four adults who, despite living with mental illness, are a testament to the fact that it doesn't have to stop you from living a fulfilling life. For many of them, their problems started during childhood.
Well, things were different back then and now, you know, because I had ADHD and ADD, ADHD, and, you know, back then they didn't, you know, and I had depression, anxiety disorder, bipolar, and I was never treated for it because I guess no one picked up on it. I don't know.
I thought I was the dumbest person in the world, to tell you the truth. I didn't know that I could learn my way and not their way.
Despite knowing something is wrong, shame or fear may keep many from looking for a diagnosis.
I was scared, very scared. You know, what would my family think? What would the people think? What would my friends think? So I tried to hide it from them, and I think I did a good job hiding it from them.
For Brittany, who had already been diagnosed as bipolar as a teenager, her fear came when schizophrenia presented itself later in life while she was living with her grandmother. All she knew is that she would hear voices and describe seeing bees and snakes coming towards her.
If I saw them, I would turn on the light and they would all go away. But I was in a room, and then I'd be in a room next, be in the room, and it would be dark and I could see them coming for me. So it was very, very scary to me.
Did you ever tell her about them?
No, I just kept saying, they know, they know, they know, and they just thought that I was crazy.
But they didn't think that you were schizophrenic or anything?
No, because I was too afraid to tell them because I was afraid that they would send me to the hospital again.
Getting help and getting treatment for a mental illness is usually something that takes time. It takes a lot of convincing for some folks to get that help and recognize that they might have a mental illness and might need some help with it.
According to Christy Garlitz, clinical director for the Lower Shore Clinic, people usually live with their symptoms until they can no longer cope with them, or in some instances, until an episode forces them to get help.
When I was about 26 years old, I got into a car accident and I flipped my car, and my dad had to EP me and send me to the hospital. And then when I was in the hospital, that's when they found out that I had schizophrenia.
In Brittany's case, it was an accident. For Dave, who didn't know he was bipolar or suffering from major depression and post-traumatic stress disorder, all compounded by alcoholism, his episode nearly cost his life.
I wanted out. I wanted to be done. I didn't want anybody to know. I didn't care about anybody. Looking back, it was sad. I really got suicidal. Tried to kill myself. Disappeared for a week, had a missing person report put out on me, stood on the 50 bridge with a knife on me for hours, just contemplating, should I do this or not?
That night, Dave explains, he passed out, intoxicated, and was later found by the Maryland State Police, a move that arguably saved his life. He ended up in 3 South, as he and many others call it, the psych ward at PRMC. It was there that he found out just what he was dealing with, a real diagnosis, something he calls a relief.
Then I was looking back at my life and realizing these are the anxiety attacks that I was having. These were the things that I thought I was having through my life, that they weren't normal. they should have been, but they weren't, just because I wasn't on any kind of medication at that time.
In part two of the series, we'll look at how Dave and the others came to get treatment, what that involves, how they felt going through it, and how through something called a peer-based culture, they slowly begin to regain control of their lives. Emily and Lenita, back to you.
All right, thank you so much, Julian. Again, 47 ABC's Julian Sidor reporting live in studio for us tonight.
And of course, parts 2 through 4 of Julian's special, Breaking the Stigma, will be airing during the news hour Tuesday through Thursday. And we want to hear what you think. Tell us on 47 ABC's Facebook or Twitter right now.